Hello, this is Sonia Hicks, and I'm the host of New Beginnings, and that's the program you're about to watch. We are live tonight. So any bloopers that you may see or we may have, we're asking you to please forgive us. And we want you to enjoy our program as we go forward. And our first guest tonight, our singer, will be Mr. CleanN. We'll interview him a little bit after the program, after he sings, rather, and we hope that you enjoy his singing of Hark the Herald Angel Sings, Mr. CleanN.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time behold him come, offspring of the Virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail incarnate deity. Pleased as man with man to dwell, Jesus, our Emmanuel. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Thank you, Mr. CleanN. And we are going to show you some commercials, some things that we have videoed in our community while he gets set up to talk to me a little bit. Here is the commercial.
Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year from everybody here at Pegasus Studios in Ithaca, New York.
Very good. Thank you. All right.
There it is.
All right.
Okay. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year from Pegasus and all the volunteers down here. Great resource in Ithaca. Anybody can come down here and make their own programming. It's a creative place. Come on down.
And now we're with Mr. CleanN. How are you?
Very good.
You're going to have a program coming up really soon that's going to be starting, and you're going to be doing it live here at the Pegasus Station. Is that correct?
Yes.
Tell
yes,
us a little
be.
Bit about the program.
It's going to be a variety show. It's going to be song, dance, interviews. I might go on to the Commons and film a street musician and then interview them afterwards. I've done a segment with a holiday meal that was done at the Presbyterian Church. I've got another segment lined up that I'm working on now about the student. I see students that are doing a student film. So it's just going to be a variety of things and really whatever everybody else, whatever all the people want to see.
And what gave you this idea?
It just kind of came to me. I just have last year or so had the vibe to do it and made several attempts to get it together, but finally now I got it all together, took the classes, now it's in production, and hopefully sometime the first of the year it should be on.
Can you tell us some of the additional people that you'd like to have on your program?
I would like to have everybody, like all kinds of stuff, what people want to see. Like it's just going to like come to me almost serendipitously. Like I was in the Presbyterian Church and these people are doing bagpipes, and I talked to the gentleman, I might do an interview with him and film them doing bagpiping and maybe some instructional stuff there. Just things will kind of like flow. Like with the segment with the students, I just happened to be coming to the mall, and there they were filming. So okay. They had this old-fashioned camera, and I just turned the camera on. I didn't even have a camera person, so I just kind of held the camera and looked into it and turned it to them. And then even some of the outtakes, I put some special effects in and kind of tried to save the rest of the film.
So you and I have both been working hard on our projects, and one of the things that I noticed is that you have an earnest desire to do a lot in your filming, but what benefit will it be for the community?
I think my main focus is like to entertain and to maybe cause some laughter and joy, some informative elements as well, a variety of different things, just putting it together, but mostly just to bring entertainment and laugh. Like it's going to have a comedic element, even if I'm doing like a serious interview, I'll try to do some sort of comedic element to bring a chuckle or a giggle or some light in the spirits, that sort of thing.
Okay, before we go on to our next guest, is there anything that you would like to say to anybody for your program preview? And when is it going to start? And give them some of that excitement you've been telling me about for the last 2-3 weeks since we talked about you being on this program.
It's coming up live. It's going to be great. Song, dance, everything that you want to hear and see. And some of the first shows might just be a live call-in show where you could call in and like tell me what you want to hear. You know, these are just some ideas that I've proposed to the Reverend here and talked about, but really it's what you want to hear. The Mr. Clean Show. Yes!
Thank you so much. Yep, yeah, they're going to turn in and they're going to come and see you. Without further ado now, we're going to go back to the commercial and... Welcome back. We're here because Jesus is the reason for the season. And we have a special guest. She is a celebrity to me. And she says she's not. Her name is Patricia Patty Blue. She is usually on the radio WEOS every Sunday morning from 7 to 9. And she has come all the way from Geneva, New York to be on this program with us tonight. And I want you to sit back and enjoy all of these wonderful songs, however many they are, that Miss Blue will sing and enjoy. And we're going to talk about her business, too. Let me say that. We're going to talk about Uncommon Threads. Patty Blue.
Jesus, Jesus, oh, what a wonderful child. Jesus, Jesus, so holy, meek and mild. New life, new hope to all he brings. Listen to the angels sing. They say glory, glory, glory to the newborn king. Let me tell you about Jesus, Jesus. Oh, what a wonderful child, Jesus, Jesus. So holy, meek and mild. New life, new hope to all he brings. Listen to the angels sing. They say glory, glory, glory to the newborn king. He was heralded by the angels, born in a lowly manger to a virgin mother. Joseph was his earthly father, and then some wise men came from afar. They were guided by a shining star to see the babe where he lay, yes, in a manger filled with hay. Let me tell you about Jesus, Jesus. Oh, what a wonderful child, Jesus, Jesus. So holy, meek and mild. New life, new hope to all he brings. Listen to the angels sing. They say glory, glory, glory to the newborn king. Glory, glory, glory to the newborn king. Glory, glory, glory to the newborn king. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright round yon virgin mother and child. Holy infant, so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace. Silent night, holy night, shepherds quake at the sight. Glorious beams from heaven above, heavenly host sing hallelujah. Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born. Christ, the Savior of the world is born. Yes, he is. Christ, the Savior is born. That's why we celebrate, because Christ
We thank you. We're going to show you some more of the other pieces of our community. Merry Christmas right now.
Structures, 5, 6, 7. Thank you. Okay.
Hey, my name is Claire. I want to say Happy New Year and Blessed Christmas. And the Prince of Peace is here. And I come from Occupy Ithaca, where we are celebrating the beauty of people coming together to make a peaceful world. Amen.
Thank you.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this is Patricia Patty Blue. She's my guest tonight, one of my guests, and welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
We're really glad that you're here. I'm glad that you sang two songs for us. I hope you get to sing at least one more. So, Patty, tell us about who you are and what you do, and just give us some information about you. I could ask you a lot of questions, because I know a lot already, but what the community doesn't know. So share with us about your radio program and your business, and just go ahead on.
Well, I'm sort of wear many different hats, so it's kind of hard to, you know, figure out where to begin. But first of all, you know, I'm a woman who loves the Lord and tries to please Him. And I am a musical person. I'm a choir director, and I'm also an entrepreneur. I have a clothing store in downtown Geneva. I live in Geneva. I was born and raised there. And with the exception of about 3 years, I've been there almost all of my life. So, you know, it's interesting, you know, doing things and pursuing your dreams in your hometown. But, you know, I just like to sing. I love to do things like this. This is a great opportunity for me. And I really love working with people. I don't know, you would probably do better to ask me questions because I tend to go off on tangents.
Okay. Now, you're in the ministry.
Yes, I consider my radio broadcast ministry. I do. And I'm also a licensed evangelist in the Church of God in Christ. I consider my choir directing also a ministry of sorts, you know, in the tradition of the Levitical praise and worshipers. So I believe that everything that we do, really, that if God has given us gifts and abilities, whatever He has given us, it is His plan for us to give it back to Him. And so I think many things I do in ministry, you know, even playing with children, that's a ministry. It's just different.
Tell me about your business, Uncommon Threads. What I really want to know is, where did the name come from?
Well, I, in my former life, was a head of a not-for-profit corporation, and I used to write a lot of grant applications, and I found myself in narrative saying that the common thread between this demographic and this problem was X, Y, and Z. And so, as I was planning to open up the store, I really didn't have a name for it. And Common Thread just sort of came to me, and I thought, well, no, these won't be common threads. They'll be uncommon threads. So, you know, threads comes from, you know, the terminology of the 60s and 70s, where, you know, people used to call their finery threads. So these are uncommon clothes. So I try to dress people in a way that is not so traditional.
Okay. You used to, I remember the first time that I heard you on the air and you were advertising or talking about a community event that happens in Geneva. And you had a quartet group coming, I forget who they were, but in a couple of years I saw that that program went on. Now that program is not all going on right now, or has that come back into the picture?
There actually has been a lot of talk about that. Unity Festival is what you're referring to, and that is a cultural festival, an African-American cultural festival that was established in 1980, and it's actually something that I observed first in a very hot political climate in Philadelphia back in like 1978, 79. There was a lot of confusion in the community and a lot of political activity, and so people came together to celebrate. And I wasn't really actually living in the city, I was living just outside, but I was glued to the tube, always listening to what was going on politically there. And this was a solution to a problem. People came together and decided to just have a day of unity. And then on the next day, you know, people were on the air talking about how it felt for everyone to come together. And I thought, gee, that would be awesome. I wish I was there. And shortly after that, I didn't realize it, but I was coming back to Geneva. It was not my plan. The Lord showed me that I was gonna be going back to Geneva. And when I got there, I saw all of this, you know, not connectedness, and thought, along with my sister Gloria, who's joined me in the studio, and some other people, and we were young and energetic then, so we said we need to have a unity festival, so we planned one. And the first event took place on the grounds of Courtyard Apartments, which at that time was called Charters Homes, and the response was overwhelming. So that event grew, and we did it probably for 15 years, making it bigger and bigger each time.
Okay.
And, you know, would bring in national talent and, you know, all kinds of things. And people would just really talk about how it really helped to make the community, particularly the African-American community, more cohesive. And one of the reasons that we stopped doing it was because while people want to be cohesive, they don't necessarily want to help you get there. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they want to enjoy the day, but I always felt right from the inception of the program that, you know, if we're going to have a unity festival, we have to be unified in putting it together, and when it's time to take it all apart, let's do that together too. It's more than just coming out to enjoy a day, because there is so much labor that goes into it. It really became too cumbersome for our organization to carry it off, Community Unified Today. But I must say that that organization brought many wonderful things to the city of Geneva, of which I am fiercely proud.
So you're getting ready to do a Martin Luther King, there's a choir, a birthday celebration?
Yes, Geneva actually is probably one of the forerunners in observing Dr. King's birthday. Again, something that came out of high school in an assembly where students on the anniversary of Dr. King's birthday actually said they would not go to class, they would not participate in classes. This was long ago, and you know, then parents were called to the school, and the next thing was that parents were like, well, yeah, we shouldn't have, this should be a holiday. And so locally people began to really, you know, try to get a holiday established. But out of all of that, so Geneva has one of the oldest MLK observances, I believe, in the upstate New York region, and possibly along in this part of the country. It's just been, it's always been a very political community. But now what has emerged is a very refined program that includes, you know, a keynote speaker that could be coming from anywhere, you know, across the country, and an MLK Memorial Choir, the Martin Luther King Memorial Choir, which is basically a choir that is assembled from people, whoever wants to sing can just come. There are so many people, I found out, Pastor Hicks, that want to sing gospel music. They don't go to anybody's church.
Mm-hmm.
They love gospel music. They don't know why it moves them. But when you go someplace and you sing at lakefront events, people are just, you know, they're just in awe. And one year I found out, I extended an invitation at the Whale Watch one year that if there's anybody in the audience that's always wanted to sing gospel, just come on up on the stage. And I thought that there would be one or two people that would come up on the stage. I was shocked when the whole audience came up on the stage. And so, you know, I taught them a song, and they sang, and I thought, gee, there's something to this. So that's really how the MLK Memorial Choir started and became a call to anyone who ever wanted to sing. And so it really is a choir that is a community choir. We rehearse three times before the service, and we present. And basically, the choir exists to provide music for the MLK observance every year. And so that's what we'll be doing this year, and we're hoping that we have great success.
Are you still the choir director?
I am.
Okay, and when is it coming up now? The actual rehearsals, are they real soon, or have they started yet?
All of that information has been sent out to people, and yes, the rehearsals have not started. The first rehearsal, the organizational meeting, is actually on December 20th. And that would be tomorrow. So people have been notified. It's been publicized locally. So, you know, the wannabe singers all probably have that information. And then there are three rehearsals that are scheduled for January, with the last rehearsal taking place on the Saturday before the Monday observance of Dr. King's birthday. So that's what people will come to the organizational meeting for. They'll get all of the facts. They'll find out what the music is going to be. And then, you know, we'll get their information, and we'll look forward to seeing them at three rehearsals, and then we'll be ready to present. They always do an amazing job.
What's the number in the choir usually?
It can be, it may start off small, but by the time we get to the event, we usually have 40 or 50 people up there, so.
Got a good musician?
Yes, very good musicians. Excellent musicians.
Oh, so you can have more than one.
Oh, yes.
Oh.
You have to, you know, you always got to have a backup plan these
gotta
days.
Got to have a backup plan. That's right. All right. Well, is there anything else you'd like to share with the audience?
Well, just that we should remember what this holiday season is really all about. And I know that, you know, probably many children just excited about opening up gifts. And, you know, I can remember Christmases at our home when we get up early in the morning and go downstairs and shake boxes and try to figure out who got what and who didn't. But, you know, we always had more than we needed, certainly. But Christmas, that's great, but that's not what Christmas is really all about. Christmas is really about the birth of our Savior who came and gave his life for us. And so it's such a great gift. And that's what we really ought to try to remember this holiday season. Giving is nice, but God gave his best so long ago for us.
Thank you. I'm really happy that you came. I hope that we will get to experience you. I would love for them, the students from Cornell University, to use you as one, as the guest choir person for FBG.